So in this video, I'm going to talk about what happens on a branch mispredict and what is the right time to wake up a dependent instruction. Okay, so let's first look at the branch mispredict issue. So, you know, going back to this figure over here, let me just draw out what's happening in my program. Okay, so I execute a bunch of instructions, I encounter a branch, and then I make a prediction, I say this is the path I'm going to go along. Okay, so my reorder buffer currently contains all of these instructions, and it also contains these instructions along one of the two paths. Okay, and my instruction fetch queue may have gone beyond this point and also started fetching the next set of instructions. Okay, so now, you know, this branch is sitting somewhere here in the reorder buffer. It's also sitting, let's say, in the issue queue waiting for its input operands to be made available. At some point, those inputs are made available, so the branch proceeds. It goes to the ALU stages, it does its math, it figures out where the branch should really be going. And at this point, it discovers that the branch had been previously mispredicted. So I've gone and fetched the wrong instructions. Okay, so what all needs to happen now to kind of recover from this branch mispredict? Okay, so firstly, every instruction after that branch in my reorder buffer have to be squashed. They have to be canceled out. Same thing happens in the issue queue as well. All these instructions have to be squashed. And the IFQ has definitely brought in all wrong instructions. So the entire IFQ contents gets squashed as well. Okay, so I'm basically removing some of the contents in my reorder buffer and issue queue and all of the contents in my instruction fetch queue. Okay, then let's look at my committed map table. It represents what has happened until this point in the program. Okay, and you know, since the branch comes after that, and since all the mispredicted instructions also come after the branch, I know that none of these instructions have impacted my committed register map table, right? So everything that I just squashed has not impacted my committed register map table, and so this is already perfectly safe and does not have to be recovered. Now let's look at the speculative register map table. This represents the state of the program until this point. Okay, so clearly this needs to be rolled back, right? I instead want the speculative map table to represent everything that has happened until this point over here, until the branch. Okay, so you know, as an example, let's, you know, there might have been some instruction over here that wrote to R1 and that got renamed to say P38. And then there might have been instruction over here that also wrote to R1 which got renamed to P47. Okay, so my speculative map table is currently saying P47. Okay, but I want to roll it back so that what it should instead say is that the latest value of R1 is sitting in P38, because we need to undo the effects of everything that happened along this mispredicted path. Okay, so how do I roll back by my speculative map table? You know, one option is to look at each one of these instructions and see what it did and somehow undo that effect. The implementation that is usually adopted in modern process is that every time you encounter a branch, that is a potential point of recovery. Okay, so anytime you encounter a branch, you just take a checkpoint of your current speculative map table. Okay, so at every branch, there is a checkpoint that is taken. So based on how many branches you have seen, you might have multiple checkpoints out there. Okay, so when you discover a branch mispredict, you say, oh, this is the third branch in my reorder buffer. So let's reinstate my third checkpoint, and that will allow me to now proceed with all the correct register mappings in my table. Okay, so you know, this is not very hard to implement, these checkpoints, because you can implement them by replacing every entry in my map table with a shift register. Okay, so every time you encounter a branch, you say, oh, this could be a possible point of recovery. Let me just shift everything in my shift register by one and essentially save my current mapping. And so later when you have a branch mispredict, you say, oh, you know, the branch three branches ago was a mispredict. So let me shift everything again to the left by three, and that'll reinstate whatever was in my map table three branches ago. Okay, so this is how you do it. So every single branch creates a checkpoint. And so when you later discover that a branch was a mispredict, you reinstate that correct checkpoint back in your speculative register map table. Okay, so this is everything that happens on a branch mispredict, which I've summarized on this slide. Okay, next I'm going to move on to a different topic, which is, you know, how do I wake up a consuming instruction? Okay, and for a minute, I will go back to my earlier example that was using an in-order pipeline. Okay, so in that pipeline, you have your instruction fetch stage, Then you have a decode stage, and now I'm going to separate decode and register read. Okay, so I have a separate register read stage, and then I have my ALU stage, and then so on. Okay, so in this case, you know, let's again take the example where you have a producing instruction, my favorite example, where you write to R1, and then a consuming instruction that reads R1. Okay, so if you look at the producer, right, it leaves the decode stage, and then it doesn't produce a result right away. It first has to read input operands from the register file, then one cycle later it does its number crunching and produces a result. Okay, so if the producer leaves decode, which is like the issue queue, right? The decode stage is like the issue queue in my in-order pipeline. So it leaves the decode stage in cycle I, and it produces a result at the end of cycle I plus 2. Okay, so two cycles later is when it produces a result. Okay, so you know, one option is to say that when I produce the result, I'll go back, tell the decode stage that I produce a result, which allows the consuming instruction to proceed right behind me. Okay, so you know, you can say that, well, once I wake it up, the consumer will leave the decode stage in cycle I plus 3, which will introduce a two cycle gap between producer and consumer. Okay, but in reality, if my consuming instruction had left the decode stage in cycle I plus 1, right, so let's assume that that it left decode stage in cycle I plus 1, it would then spend cycle I plus 2 reading something from the register file. Okay, and then at the start of cycle I plus 3, it would reach the ALU. And at that point, the first instruction has produced a result, and that can get bypassed to the ALU. Okay, so it's actually safe for my consuming instruction to leave the decode stage as early as cycle I plus 1. That is, even before a value has been produced by the producer. Okay, because the decode stage knows that, you know, by the time you get to the ALU, the producer would have produced a result, and that can be bypassed to you through the bypass network. Okay, so you know, what the decode stage ends up doing is it actually lets the consuming instruction issue or leave the decode stage even before the input values have been produced. Okay, and a similar concept is also used in this out-of-order pipeline, right? So I have an issue queue, and I said that when somebody leaves the issue queue, you know, they may have to read something from the register file. They then proceed to the ALU stage, and when a result is produced, it gets written into the register, and I said that I also broadcast the availability of that value. Okay, so this broadcast need not happen after the value is produced in the ALU. It can happen sooner. Okay, so if the producer is a simple ALU operation that takes, you know, one cycle to finish, then if the producer leaves in cycle I, in the very next cycle, I wake up the dependent and let it proceed. If the producer is going to be a floating point add operation that takes four cycles, then I wait for four cycles before I broadcast a wake up through my issue queue, and I wake up my dependent instructions. Okay, so note that in my issue queue, if my operation is a low latency operation, then I can wake up my dependents in perhaps the very next cycle, and I don't have to wait for a value to be produced. Okay, so wake up is always somewhat speculative. It is based on an estimate of how long an instruction is going to take to finish, and whether it is safe to issue the dependent in the next cycle or the following cycle, and so on. Okay, so you don't actually wait for a value to be produced before you do a broadcast of the issue queue. Okay, so I just wanted to clarify exactly how that wake up process works. Now, in the next video, I will integrate a load store queue into my out of order design.